Well, today is a new day, and it's the new church year. And the title of the message is, It's God's Vision, a New Church Year. So if you have your Bible, turn to the book of Habakkuk chapter 2, and we'll begin reading with verse 1 through 4. You might want to know why Lucas is taking up the offering. Well, he's an usher in training, okay? So we hope to get our children involved. One thing we're looking forward to in this new church year is doing things as family for the whole church. That's one of our values here, and we're going to be talking about that. So if you've got your Bibles, hope you found the book of Habakkuk, okay, chapter 2. Let's all stand in reverence to the reading of God's holy, infallible, inspired, and inerrant word. I'm excited about this message today, and I believe you'll receive a great blessing by being here today. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1. I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower, and will watch to see what he will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, Write the vision and make it plain upon the tables, that he that run that readeth it, that's important, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the reading of the word of God today, and we pray that, Lord, we'll not take your word lightly. Lord, we will receive your word. You have written it down for us. We have the Bible, and I pray that we'll not ever take this for granted, the written word of God. And Lord, as we share today a written vision, I pray that your Holy Spirit would anoint this time together for every leader in this church to clearly understand the importance of the vision, Lord, for we believe that it is from you. It's God's vision. And we pray that we will not miss you, but that we will join you. Help us to understand your word and how you use Habakkuk in his day to make a difference. Use us to make a difference in our day. Help us, Lord, as we continue to focus on who's your one, that we'll pray for that person and pray for the opportunity to share the gospel story. I pray for your anointing now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. God's vision. There's a big difference between God's vision and man's vision. A godly vision is right for the time, right for the church, and it's right for his people. A godly vision, listen to this carefully, promotes faith, never fear. A godly vision motivates people to action. A godly vision requires risk-taking. A godly vision glorifies God, not people, not a church. Proverbs 29:18 says, Where there is no vision, the people what? Perish. But I would believe also that where there is a vision, the people flourish. Now, we need to have a right understanding of this scripture. I read this week that there's no scripture that's been taken out of context more than Proverbs 29:18. A more correct understanding in the Hebrew is this, where there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint. The difference is people can come up with their own vision, but God reveals his vision according to his perfect will. The word perish there means to die or to backslide. And there's a lot of dead churches out there. You know, if you never plan to get anywhere, you won't. Amen? If you don't ever set any goals for your life, and you know, all this can be taken personally. I hope you will. Because you know what? Without a vision in your own life, you will die. You'll backslide. You need purpose. You need meaning. The difference is people can come up with their own vision and miss God. A vision is the comprehensive statement that tells leaders of the organization what direction they should move and what they should accomplish so they can motivate other people with them. The church should be and strive toward a preferred future, not just a dream. It's wonderful to dream a dream, but it's another thing to put a vision into action. And so my heart's desire today is to help you maybe get on track in your own personal life as far as your walk with God. A lot of people are off track today. You can tell that. I mean, people are just living any old way, doing any old thing, thinking that there's no consequences. Folks, everything that we do has consequences. Bible says, what you sow, you reap. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. He that sows to the flesh shall the flesh reap corruption. He that sows to the Spirit shall the Spirit reap life everlasting. So you've got a choice to make. What kind of seed you sow? I tell our young people, the choices you make, make you. So let's first of all talk about vision, okay? Vision. Verse 1 talks about it. We're going to talk about our position. But I want you to get this for a moment. I thought this was pretty profound. You know, when the Epcot Center, you know, the Disney World, it was finished in 1982. Walt Disney had already passed away. Disney executives asked Walt Disney's wife to cut the ribbon at the opening of the Epcot Center. When she was called up to the podium, one of the executives said to her, "Miss Disney, I just wish Walt could have seen this." And her reply was, "Oh, he did. Had he never seen it, you would have never seen it." And see, that's the thing I want us to begin to realize, this vision. God's already seen it. We need to see it, because he's already seen it. Are you in a position to see God at work in you and in your family and in your church? Number one, I want you to understand what Habakkuk was talking about when he talked about his position. Notice what he says, and I want you to think about our position as a church. It reads in verse 1, "I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower." The Greek word for watch there is sophah, which means to keep an eye on something. Are we in position to hear God? Do we understand that he deserves our undivided attention? You know, it's a challenge to preach today because people's attention span is so short. I don't deserve your attention, but God does. So we need to give him our undivided attention. What is your position? Where do you stand in your walk with God? I love R.C. Stroll, and he's a popular Presbyterian theologian. He was recently asked, "What do you think is the greatest spiritual need in the world today?" And he answered, "The greatest spiritual need in the world today is for people, is that people need to discover the true identity of God, to simply know who God is, that they may see and recognize and consider and gain insight as well." Henry Blackaby says it this way: see where God is at work, and then you join him. I like that. And so I want us to see God at work. Are you in the right position to give your very best to God? Or are you defeating yourself with your own mouth, with your own words? I absolutely detest negative talking. It'll never get you nowhere. And if you don't think you will get anywhere in your life, you won't. A positive attitude says everything. One of my favorite movies, Christian movies that came out years ago, was Facing the Giants. And so I want us to take a few minutes. I'm giving up sermon time, and this sermon's not that long, so you'll be happy about that. But I just thought to myself, this is worth watching. So I want you to watch this clip from Facing the Giants. It's called The Death Crawl. And think about our church and our position, and maybe what we need to do is to get our focus on the Lord. Look how this coach coached one of his players to get his focus right. So can we watch that?
So, Coach, how strong is Westview this year?
A lot stronger than we are.
You already written Friday night down as a loss, bro?
Well, not if I knew we could beat them.
Come here, Brock. You too, Jeremy.
What, am I in trouble now?
Not yet. I want to see you do the death crawl again, except I want to see your absolute best.
What, you only go to the 30?
I think you can go to the 50.
The 50? I can go to the 50 if nobody's on my back.
I think you can do it with Jeremy on your back. But even if you can, I want you to promise me you're going to do your best.
All right.
Your best.
Okay.
You going to give me your best?
I'm going to give you my best.
All right, one more thing. I want you to do it blindfolded.
Why?
Because I want you giving up at a certain point when you can go further. Get down. Jeremy, get on his back. Now get a good tight hold, Jeremy. All right. Let's go, Brock. Keep your knees off the ground. Just your hands and feet. There you go. A little bit left. A little bit left. There you go. Show me good effort. Shall we, Brock? You keep coming. There you go. It's a good start. A little bit left. A little bit left. There you go, Brock. Good strength. That's it, Brock. That's it.
Better than 20 yet?
Forget the 20. You give me your best. You keep going. That's it. Now, don't stop, Brock. You got more in you than that.
I ain't done. I'm just resting a second.
You gotta keep moving. Let's keep moving. Let's go. Don't quit till you got nothing left. There you go. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving it. Your very best. Your very best. Your very best. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. Don't quit on me. Keep going. Keep driving it. Keep your knees off the ground. That's it. Your very best. Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving it. Don't quit till you got nothing left. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. I want everything you got. Come on, keep going.
It hurts.
Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go.
He's heavy.
I know he's heavy.
I'm out of strength.
Then you negotiate with your body to find more strength, but don't you give up on me, Brock. You keep going. You hear me? You keep going. You're doing good. You keep going. Do not quit on me. You keep going.
It hurts.
I know it hurts. You keep going. You keep going. It's all hard from here. 30 more steps. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Keep going.
Burn.
And let it burn.
It's burning.
It's all hard. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Come on. Keep going. You will be your best. Your best. Don't stop. Keep going.
Too hard.
It's not too hard. You keep going. Come on, Brock. Give me more. Give me more. Keep going. 20 more steps. 20 more. Keep going, Brock. Give me your best.
Most influential player on this team. If you walk around defeated, so will they. Don't tell me you can't give me more than what I've been seeing. You just carried a 140-pound man across this whole field on your arms. Brock, I need you. God's gifted you with the ability of leadership. Don't waste it.
Herbs?
Can I count on you?
Yes.
Herbs?
What is it, Jeremy?
I want a 160.
All right, who's next? Here's the thing. Say this with a heavy heart. There's not a person in this church who hadn't been hurt, hadn't been burnt. But we don't quit. You don't give up. You don't quit. Because God gave His very best for us. He deserves my best. And I haven't been giving Him 100%. Have you? We can give God 100%. If that boy can carry a 140, 160-pound man on his back, we might have to carry some burdens. but we don't quit. You just keep on going. I wanted to share that with you today because we've got to move forward as a church, because there's a lot of people out there who need the Lord. And I am the kind of pastor, I don't just want to see a church switching church members. I'm the kind of guy that wants to reach the lost. That's my heart. Had a man in my office one day here, and he said, I need to know your vision for this church. I'd been here about 3 months. I said, well, my heart's always been to reach the lost. I would love to lead Gord Springs Baptist Church to be an evangelistic church. He said, I won't be here. I don't believe the church is to be evangelistic. But if it weren't for some church being evangelistic, I probably would have never got saved, nor would you have. Somebody reached out to me. Someone loved me. Someone prayed for me. And so I'm going to take the time to pray for someone else. Attitude is everything. In context of this verse, Habakkuk was confused by God's response in chapter 1 because he knew about the cruelty and the wickedness of the Babylonians. He wondered how a holy God could use such an unholy and ruthless nation to punish men who were more unrighteous than they. God had to get Habakkuk in the position to hear him. And oftentimes, God will get us in that position that we can hear him. Sometimes we just got to get desperate enough to hear him. So the next point I want to make is that he said, write it plain. He said that your position is that you stand, but make it plain. The vision is more than a dream. It is striving toward a clear, precise, preferred, defined future. The vision needs to be simple, yet concise. Fewer than 100 words. Our vision has 8 words in it. So it can be remembered and it can be followed. Vision prompts us to move where God has taken us. So it simply needs to be played. Did you know the gospel is simple? Do you know God is simple? There's nothing complicated. So we just need to make it plain. Our vision, our position, where does our church stand? And we need to be plain about it. And then we need to understand our purpose when it comes to vision. Verse 3. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. For such a time as this. What is your purpose? Do you have a purpose-driven church? Do you have a purpose-driven life? What is it that really drives you? You know, what really drove Brock was that coach coaching him and encouraging him. And, you know, we need that encouragement. We need to have that drive. But what drives us? There's more in us than we think. Number one, we've got God in us. Amen. I mean, that ought to drive us enough. For God so loved us that he gave his only begotten son. Listen, we love him because he first loved us. Amen. Not only does God love us, he proved to us he loved us. He sent his son to die on the cross for us. Hello? Not only did he send his son to die on the cross for us, his son rose again from the grave. That ought to motivate us. Amen? But then Jesus said, I'm going to leave with you a comforter, the Holy Spirit. And he's the drive. And if the Holy Spirit's not driving a church, it's a dead church. It is. It's dead. It may be driven by people. It may be driven by law. And a church can be driven by different things. But what should really drive us is the work of the Holy Spirit in us. Your church can choose to stop any place it decides. It is seldom an issue of potential, but of attitude and vision that determines what people do. The future purpose of God is seen in Habakkuk 2:14. Notice what it says there. The earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of Jehovah as the waters cover the sea. That is the revelation that really Proverbs 29:18 is all about. That they might have revelation, that they may not perish, that they may not backslide, that they may not lose ground. God has a plan. Will we join him? Psalm 139 verses 13 through 17 says, God, before I was ever created, you had a plan, a purpose for my life. You had a vision for me. And if you don't have a plan to get somewhere, you never will. The word reprove in the last part of verse 1 means that God will correct me when I'm doing something wrong. And you know, this is how God works. And this is the way I even thought as an 11-year-old boy. I thought, well, you know what? I don't know what God's called me to do, but I'm going to try to see if this is what God wants me to do. So I joined the youth choir. They kicked me out. They did. They said, you can't sing. I ended up in the basement of the church printing bulletins. I thought, well, maybe that's my call. Some printing company had donated their whole printing press. And so I learned how to use all this stuff and I did it all. And I was there to help the pastor out. Didn't know that one day God was going to call me into the ministry. But you know what? The key is be obedient to whatever God is leading you. Try. If God don't want you, try the choir. And if they kick you out, then find something else to do, okay? That's what I did. But know your purpose. What is your purpose? What is your purpose-driven life for? To glorify God. Because when you glorify God, you're going to be happy. Oh, yeah. You see, you were created for His glory. Now, are y'all listening to me? If you're doing what you want to do, you're going to be miserable. If you're just living your life for yourself, you're a selfish person, you only think of you, and you think you're God on earth. You are one miserable creature. But if you understand that there was a God who created you and you were created for His glory. And church, let me tell you something. The church is only here by God's purpose. Lord Springs would not exist if it weren't for God. It wouldn't. This church wouldn't be. And you wouldn't be here. I think I'm right in saying this because of the sovereignty of God, because of His providential will, that we are exactly the church He wants us to be right now. You say, well, I don't like what I see. I don't like what I see. But you know what? I'm not God, and neither are you. Amen. Hello? We've got to learn to realize that God has a purpose, and He has a plan, and He will position us so that He can use us. So let's let God use us. The second part is where God's going to use us. Envision. Envision. It means putting the vision into practice. It means to imagine a future possibility, to visualize. So He says in verse 1, and we'll watch to see what He will say. Watch is the key word there. Watching for God. Are you looking for God? I'm telling you something, folks. You better be looking. He's coming again. Amen. And we're closer than ever before. But watch. He says, watch to see what He will say to me. You see that in verse 1, the latter part? It is our safest way in times of temptation and perplexity not to lie down under discouragement, but to recollect ourselves and fix our eyes on God, who only can clear our minds and quiet our spirits. Therefore, the prophet, after his deep plunge into temptation, he sets himself to look to God and to get somewhere to answer upon his arguing, because he was arguing with God in chapter 1. Did you know you can't win an argument with God? Habakkuk was arguing with God about the Babylonians, and he was upset because of God's coming judgment. And finally, he actually says this in verse 1. He says, I'll just keep my mouth shut. I'll just go up into the watchtower, and I'll be still, and I'll see what He will say to me, and I will wait for an answer that I might be reproved, he said, because I know God's going to correct me. And folks, you can just go ahead and count this. God is right, and we're wrong. Yeah, yeah, you can just go ahead and take that to the bank. God is right. He's never wrong. And so that's what the prophet is saying here. The excitement of knowing you've heard from God, you will want to proclaim it. You will want to run with it. You will want to tell others. And so the first word, Johnny, under envision is watch. That's what we've been talking about. Watch. The second word is write. Okay? It says, and the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. So we're fixing to write the vision. He says, write it. Why would He say write it? Because it's important. Because there's something about writing it down. There's just something about seeing it on paper. This was important. And make it plain upon the tables that he may run that readeth it. That's very important. A vision cannot be written from your will, but only from God's will. The vision must be God's. Now notice what he said, that he may run with it. That he may run. Not that he that readeth it may run, but he may run that readeth it. is write this vision, make it plain, so that when people read it, they will be excited about it, they will go with it, they will run, and they will share it. In other words, this is the envision, putting it into practice. A faith without works is what, church? It's dead. So let's write it down, and let's show you today what I believe God is trying to speak to us about, and that is the vision that God would have for Gorge Springs Baptist Church. Habakkuk 2:2, and the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Well, we've written the vision. We selected a vision team over a year ago, and you will not believe how every one of these words were prayed over, discussed, pulled apart, put back together. All kinds. There's a lot of other things that went along with it that I'll talk more about, the values and the strategy. But right now, let's just write the vision. Transforming our communities one person at a time. Now, I'm fixing to give you something here that's going to be mind-boggling, I think, for you and for me, because God does know the future, and we had no idea when this vision was written what God was going to do next. So the next slide is this. Transforming our communities one person at a time. We knew nothing about who's your one. Is this a God thing? Because the vision is transforming our communities one person at a time. And all of a sudden, here comes the National Baptist, the Southern Baptist Convention, with a challenge because baptisms are low, the churches are not growing, with a whole new emphasis. Who's your one? You know what I see who's your one is? Confirmation of the vision God's given this church. I do. Now, that's my point of view. Taking our vision outside the walls of this church, not just Gorge Springs, but God's vision, taking it outside of the walls of this church, transforming our communities one person at a time. So you need to know this. What we're planning as a church is intentional. You really need to be a part of the community prayer and praise service, because the community prayer and praise service came out of this vision. It did. To help transform our communities. How are we going to transform our communities if our churches can't even get together? Hello? So we got to praying. There's five pastors. We meet every week. Right now we're meeting on Thursday nights. And we're praying that God would join us together, that we all could transform our communities one person at a time. Because, folks, this vision is not Gorge Springs' vision. This is God's vision. Amen. In fact, if you wanted to go back. Can you go back one and look at that? Transforming our communities one person at a time. If you think about that, that's parallel with the Great Commission. Sure it is. Yeah. Transformation is all about discipleship, Jeremy. And Jeremy is our new discipleship director, which is the same as Sunday school director. And if we're going to really make an impact, not only do we need to lead people to Christ, we need to disciple them. We need to teach them. We need to show. That's why Jesus said in the Great Commission, to go ye therefore into all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. And look what he says. Look what he says. And lo, I will be with you. I'll be with you every step of the way. Some of you are scared to death maybe about who's your one. You hadn't even tried praying maybe for it. But I would strongly encourage you to at least pray. How does this work, preacher? Well, it's real simple. Say Sherry's lost, and I start praying for Sherry. And man, all of a sudden, now, number one, I'm already out of order because I'm a man. So, you know, but she's my wife. I'm just using her as an example. Men need to be praying for men, women with women, because you're going to establish a relationship with them. Okay? So when you start praying for somebody, you know what? That says you're caring about that person. You care enough to pray for them. And as you pray and as you pray and as you pray, you know what God's going to do? He's going to give you a more desire to get to know that person. And all of a sudden, you'll be getting to know this person, establish a relationship with them, and before you know, you're going to be leading them to Christ. Think about the simple math of this. And this is New Testament. If we followed our vision, transforming our communities one person at a time, this church wouldn't be big enough to put the people in our communities. We live in a community that's ever growing. And make it this simple. What if we just chose to reach one? Well, that would double the church right there, wouldn't it? Sure it would. Well, what's it about? Is it about numbers? No. Is it about doubling the church? No. It's about the people who are dying and going to an eternal hell. That's what it's all about. Amen. And we want to transform that. You want to live in a better community? Start leading people to Christ. You want to live in a better United States of America? Start leading people to Christ. You want a better world to live in? Let's send more missionaries so that more people can learn about Jesus. But then it's interesting to envision. It says not only do we watch, we write, but we wait. Let's move on. He says in verse 3, though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Now, it's interesting. I just shared all that with you, that we've waited on the Lord at this time. I don't quite get it myself. Look up here. I'm not God, but He is. And let me tell you something. God knew when the vision was put in place that there was going to come a confirmation on who's your one. I like reading. I read for many, many years Oswald Chambers' book, My Utmost for His Highest. Here's a quote, and it's going to be on the board. The next slide. God gives us the vision. This is heavy duty for us. Then He takes us down to the valley to batter us into the shape of the vision. And it is in the valley that so many of us faint and give away. Every vision will be made real if we have patience to wait on the Lord. A lot of people don't have patience. A lot of people don't know what to do when storms come, when hardship comes, when a church is going through a storm or a hardship. What do you do? Look up here. The anchor holds in Jesus Christ. You stand on the Word of God. That's where you stand. You don't ever back up. You don't ever give up. You don't ever shut up. Brock, give me your best. Well, I can make it to 30 yards if nobody's on my back. But the man did a death crawl from one end of the field to the other into the end zone with a 160-pound man on his back just because he was encouraged and coached. I'll tell you, we need to be encouraging each other. You know what? I don't know about you, but I'm about up to here with discouragement. You know, it's easy to hear discouragement. You hear it everywhere you go. And, you know, it's funny, almost every Sunday, you know, the most discouraging time for me is between 10 o'clock and 11 o'clock. Satan will always plant something. I mean, there's always a little something to bring back a memory or something to get me off track. But I'll tell you something. He's having a hard time because the anchor holds. Amen. I'm just going to keep trusting in the one who has never failed me. People will fail you. Churches will fail you. But God will never fail you. Amen. Now, who do you put your trust in? Friend, I'm going to tell you something. God gives us the vision He wants us to have. He puts us in the valley to batter us into the shape that He wants us to be in. It is in the valley that so many of us will faint and give up. But every vision will be made real if we just learn to wait upon the Lord. And He says, wait upon the Lord, and He shall renew your strength. Mount up with wings as eagles. Run and not grow weary. Walk and not faint. We've got the victory. The choir sung it this morning. I hope and pray for Gorge Springs Baptist Church. That's not in song only. I'm going to walk in the victory. My victory's in Jesus. Amen. Why don't we praise Him and thank Him? Learn to wait. I love that quote. Then last, and I'm done, is God's provision. This is important that I share this. He says in verse 4, behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith. You know that statement's in Romans. Martin Luther, the theologian, he posted that scripture on the door of the Catholic Church, which started the Reformation of where we are today. That one statement, the just shall live by faith. He is our provision. Number one, our future. He says, behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. As the vision undoubtedly related to the destruction of the Babylonian monarchy, which is plainly foretold in Habakkuk verse 5 there. And this, I'm giving you, in fact, verse 5 and the rest of chapter 2. It's all about the destruction of the Babylonians. God is our provider. And if we think we can do it on our own, God will let us. But do you really want to live your future without God? I'll tell you, Jesus said it right. Without me, you can do nothing. Now, I'm almost done. I want you to get this today. The Babylonian monarchy was strong, and they thought they could do it. And by the way, you read Daniel and how that there was Nebuchadnezzar who exalted himself above God, and he ended up as an animal eaten in the pasture like a cow, okay? And then there was his grandson, Belshazzar, who thought he'd take the holy vessels of God, and he was going to offer them to his gods of iron, wood, and stone, which see not, nor hear, nor know. And about the time he offered one of those vessels that had been used in worship before the true God, an armless hand began to write on the wall, Mena, Mena, Tekel, Upharsin, which means God's judgment is about to come on you, buddy. God's judgment is about to come on America. We better wake up, church. If we want a bright future, we better get back to the one who holds the future. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow. I know he's in control. I know that he's sovereign God. And regardless of what you and I do, I'll tell you what's going to happen. His plan will be accomplished. He had the first word, he'll have the last. What kind of future do you have? What kind of future? God is our provider. If we think we can do it on our own, he'll let us. Our future will be destined to fail without him. Jesus said it best when he said, you must depend upon me for your future. Look what he says in Matthew 23:12. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. You know what this verse is really talking about? Being puffed up. Notice he says, and you lift up yourself. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. He's puffed up. He's full of himself. He thinks he can make it without God. Do you want a future with God in it? Then humble yourself under his mighty hand. And the Bible says he will exalt you in due time. Habakkuk 2:4, if you puff up, lift up yourself, you will be upright. You will not be upright in him. You may be upright in what you think, but you won't be upright in him. The second is forgiveness. Future and forgiveness. I got sidetracked. I'm sorry. Verse 4. But the just shall live. The just shall live. How will the just live? God has justified us. He's made us righteous in Jesus Christ. He chose to offer forgiveness and redemption for my past and my present and my future. Because Jesus says it is finished. I will be what God has called me to do and finish the course. I'll tell you, thank God he's provided forgiveness for us. Isn't it wonderful that we have a hard time forgiving ourselves, but that God is willing to forgive us quickly. How quick will God forgive you? Just like that. Call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things. What's the greatest and most mighty thing that God's ever done for you when he forgave? Do you feel forgiven today? He says, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank God for the provision that we have because of the cross of Jesus Christ. And then the last word, and I'm done, is faith. And that's an important word for our church. He says, shall live by faith. He knows how to turn our fear into faith. It always seems, when it comes down to doing ministry for most Baptist churches, and I've been in them all my life, it seems it comes down to finances, when it should always come down to faith that works. You see, you can depend on what man can do, or you can depend on what God can do. A lot of people say, well, it can't be done because we don't have the finances to do it. Did you know God owns the cattle of 1,000 hills, and he owns the hills too? And there's nothing ever that God has ever given a people a vision to do that he didn't provide the way. Amen. I mean, you look at God's provision in Scripture. God provided with promise. God's vision, it was a day of judgment, I know, was to destroy the earth. But God's provision with promise was Noah's ark in a rainbow. God's vision for Israel was to lead them into the promised land. And God's provision was it was a land flowing with milk and honey. But because they did not accept God's vision of the promised land, the entire generation died out, and God rose up a whole new generation for the promised land. God's vision for all humanity was to give his son to die on the cross for man's sin. His provision with promise is in John 1:12. But as many as receive him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. I'm going to ask you to bow your head with me. Every head bowed, every eyes closed. God is wanting to do something in your life and mine today. It comes down to this. Will we believe him and accept it? You know, this is a great vision. And I'm going to ask you to be, we've prayed about this. I'm going to ask you as a church to make a decision at our business conference coming up. Will you choose to make this the vision for Gorge Springs Baptist Church? Transforming our communities one person at a time. I believe with all my heart that God sent Who's Your One campaign, the emphasis on that, to just confirm to us, he could have done it just for us, to say, you know what, this is the vision I want. Transforming our communities one person at a time. Who's your one? Have you prayed for that person? Maybe you're that one today that needs God's forgiveness. Guess what? He'll forgive you today. He'll come into your heart. He'll give you a bright future. You can have the assurance that you have an eternal home with him. It all comes down to faith. Will you put your faith in him right now? Faith is simply not seeing it, but trusting God, because God sees it. And God saw his son die on that cross. We didn't see him die. We believe by faith that he did, but Jesus died on that cross and he rose again so he could come and live in you. And I wonder right now, if there's a person today, you never trusted Christ as your Savior, and you'd like to do that right now, would you pray this simple prayer right where you are, just silently? No one else needs to hear you, but God knows your heart. He'll hear your prayer. Just say, dear God, just pray this prayer. I know I've sinned, and I ask you, Lord Jesus, to forgive me of all my sin, to come into my heart and save my soul. And from this day on, I surrender my all to Jesus Christ. Thank you for dying on the cross. Thank you for raising again that you might live in me, in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer, I'm going to invite you right now. We're going to sing a song of invitation. Without him, and without him, there is no future. So I'm going to ask you to trust him right now. Let's all stand together, and we're going to sing Without Him.